board meeting is called to order. Roll call.
Board members Brenmoen, Basuri, Jalali, Nelson, Naker, Tao, Tolbert, Chair Prince. 5 present, 2 absent, being board members Tolbert and Brenmoen, who is excused. Item number 1, Resolution 19-1649, Knight Foundation Gift Acceptance Resolution.
Is there any discussion on this item? I think normally we'd put this on a consent agenda, but with it being only one item we talked about, that then we can actually discuss it if we'd like. So, but it looks like good news. So, hearing none, Mr. Busuri moves approval. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion passes.
5 in favor, none opposed. The resolution is adopted. Item number 2, staff report 19-109, Read Brave 2020.
We are so excited to hear about 2020 Read Brave, so take it away.
Thank you, Board Chair Prince and board members. Public libraries are essential in a healthy, thriving democracy, and Read Brave is really a peak example of what that looks like in action. So we are thrilled today to have Marika Stalock, who is our library staff member, who is our project lead for Read Brave, to share our plans for 2020 and invite your participation with us.
Great.
Hello. Do we have a PowerPoint that's going to be coming up, or is that?
It doesn't seem like the. Do you have the?
I see it attached.
And it sounds like the mics aren't working. Can you?
Yeah, is it? Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll be sure to speak up. Soon.
Technical problems.
I'm not the one to fix it.
Luckily, tech support to distract.
Di's the tech guy.
Yeah, Di.
We're talking about you, Di. He's so focused.
Mind like a steel.
So that makes him as a kid.
I guess that's true. He does. He learns how to block out the noise. Here we go.
Hooray. I'm so glad you know how to draw this.
There it is.
There it is.
Excellent.
All right. So thank you for the introduction. I'm Marika Stalock. I'm the Youth Services Manager for the libraries, and I'm here to talk to you about Read Brave. Just a little bit of history. In 2013, Read Brave started as a citywide intergenerational program that tackled tough questions pertinent to teens by reading a YA novel, young adult novel, and discussing its topics. The idea was that it was easier to address these issues through talking about fictional characters in a shared story than addressing them head on in real life. The year it started, we got a boost from Lady Gaga's Born Brave tour, so that was the inspiration for the name of the program. And then in 2018, when Mayor Carter took office, he asked if the library, if we could form a citywide book club to engage residents around difficult issues the city was facing. And so we reworked Read Brave to become a program set around a common theme to that's relevant to our city. And so in 2019, the theme was housing insecurity, and this year's theme is our climate crisis. We've got several partners. We're excited to be working closely this year with the Science Museum of Minnesota. And then we are also excited to partner with the mayor's office, specifically Russ Stark, and the chief resilience officer for the city. And we're also grateful to have the support of the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library. So our vision, we want to elevate the voices of youth and the voices of Black, Indigenous, and people of color, and our community as a whole, to engage St. Paul residents in brave intergenerational conversations on our climate crisis and connect residents with ways to combat that crisis. So we aren't the holder of the knowledge as the library. We want to be the ones to start the conversations, connect people with the resources and the ways to combat our climate crisis. Read Brave will build awareness, pique curiosity, and incite empathy through books and book-based programming and activities. By reading fiction and talking about fictional characters and scenarios, we help build awareness and empathy in a way that is not as scary, difficult, or intimidating. We aim to engage 7,000 people this year. Last year, our goal was to engage 5,000 people within the next 3 years, and we actually already surpassed that. So now our new goal of 7,000 is our stretch this year through 40 community partners, and we are on track to do that. So a little bit more about our climate crisis. I know that you've all heard about Greta, and we've been really finding motivation in the voices of young people on this issue. The current state of the environment affects us all, and it affects the Black, Indigenous, people of color, the elderly, and the very young the hardest. Read Brave aims to unite residents around this topic, to seek understanding of the science, to share stories about its impact, and to work together towards solutions. So local headlines addressing Minnesota's rising temperatures, extreme storms, and intense flooding are in our news. We're also hearing national news describing the impacts of global heating. We all have personal stories about how the climate crisis is hitting us. And Read Brave calls on our community to be brave in the face of this big and complex issue. We believe that our residents, we believe in them and their ability to face the truth and to rise up to meet the challenges with strength, optimism, and a sense of community. We believe that this crisis and hope can coexist. So we hope to have you join us in reading and learning and coming together as a community around this important topic. I'd like to share with you the book selections. They are not officially, they will be announced officially in November, so you're getting a sneak peek here. Our primary selection is the young adult novel, The Marrow Thieves by Canadian Métis author Cherie Dimeline. And this is a young adult novel which imagines a dystopian where future global warming has ravaged the earth and with it most abilities, people's ability to dream. And I'm not going to give you too much more information about that because you can read the story. It's very good. Dimeline will be coming to visit St. Paul and do several class visits and then public events as well in March, March 11th through 13th. Our nonfiction selection to tie along with that is Climate Justice, Hope, Resilience, and the Fight for a Sustainable Future by Mary Robison, the former president of Ireland. And we also have Read Brave Kids. We took our popular I Read, I Vote program and transformed it into Read Brave Kids, where public libraries and schools partner together to empower young readers and artists by engaging in fun activities that celebrate kid choice, but giving them a voice and a vote in which one is their favorite. These are some featured books, but we have book lists for each of these age groups. So the featured books are The Digger in the Flower by Minnesota author Joseph Keffler. We also have If Polar Bears Disappeared by Lily Williams is for our early grades, grades 1 through 4. And then Bayou Magic is our selected pick for middle grades, grades 5 through 8. But again, there's a whole selection of books, a whole list of them for teachers and students to be reading throughout the whole program. How families participate in that is that they can read and rate the program or the books. They can vote on their favorite, and they can design a bookmark, all trying to enhance kind of the civic responsibilities that kids, so that kids feel connected to voting and to literacy at the same time. So some key dates around Read Brave coming up. We've got, we'll be accepting requests for giveaway books via an online form on October 19th. So that's for our school and community partners. If they're wanting to have copies to hand out to their communities, they are welcome to request that on October 19th. Read Brave will officially launch on November 20th. And like I already said, the author will be coming in March, and we will culminate on the 50th anniversary of Earth Day. So the public launch is at the 24 Hours of Reality event. It is the climate reality leader volunteers that were recently trained by Vice President Al Gore. They're going to be holding public presentations and conversations with our partners at the Science Museum. Partners to date include the Science Museum, the libraries, the City of St. Paul, Climate Generation, and the St. Paul Chamber of Climate Reality. Planning is currently underway for this event, and you will expect more details soon. So ways to get involved. We do hope for participation in the 24 Hours of Reality launch on November 20th and 21st. We hope that you will read and encourage your friends, family, and colleagues and constituents to read too. There's book clubs and partnerships with libraries. You can participate in story times and, of course, sharing on social media. And this is a list of contacts for us.
Excellent. Are there any questions, Mr. Tao?
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Chair. There's a quick question about your slide, the one. By the way, this is exciting, and it's educating our family, our members of our community. There was a slide here about the participation. Oh, how family participate?
Yes.
And so I'm just guessing that where you are on your socioeconomic status, your relation to climate crisis and climate change might be different, because a person who don't have food on the table, that might be more important than the real crisis of climate change, right? And
correct.
So they might relate to that differently. And so I'm just wondering, in your programming, are there intentional discussion about the intersection of climate crisis and the effect on people of color and poor working whites, so that this become more than just a socioeconomic issue or class issue, you know what I mean?
Yes, I do know what you mean, and thank you for bringing up that very important topic. That's very important on many levels. We are going to be trying to engage many people from the community to help us figure out the best way to be communicating some of these topics to different community members. We don't, as a library, we don't anticipate providing all of the programming itself. We look to work with community partners so that we are doing the programs within the community. So connecting with, I'm trying to think some good examples for you, but we are connecting with some of the Native communities around here that are doing some great work within the Nibby Walks and what's happening over on the east side. We are in talks to try to make sure that we are not portraying this as an answer, but more of a conversation. We're trying to start the conversation. With the very young kids too, we do know it can be detrimental to bring up the idea of a climate crisis, mm-hmm. Because it makes children scared to engage with nature. It can actually be counter to the message. And so we are learning through the research that with the very young, you really just need to talk about the love of nature and how to engage with nature. So I see that as being a focus for our very young. So to comment on this slide, that's going to be our way of connecting with the schools, probably up to grade four, they say. Mm-hmm. And then after that, then they can start hearing about climate change. But yes, that is something we're taking very seriously in trying to engage the community in a real way, so they're not further exacerbating the problem.
Okay.
Ms. Jalali Nelson. Oh, sorry.
Follow up, is that okay?
Yeah.
So I think, and I'm sure you thought about this already, but like this reading piece and the activity, I think it's like the discovery, the educating our young readers and our family. And then is there like a call to action if people want to participate? So like connecting this, the intellectual piece here to the like the city, all citywide cleanup days, like is there, will you be connecting those dots or I'm just curious.
Great question. I think the call to action will look different for our different age groups. The call to action for the very young is that they learn to, that they start voting on their favorite book, and then encouraging also older people to register to vote as a call to action. And then we will be connecting to several events happening throughout. So I know that the Science Museum has been talking about they're going to be having a large summit right after Earth Day. And so they see this as a launching off to more action to follow. I've been also talking with Angie Tilges and her work with the Great River Passage, and using this as a ramp up to get people excited to connect to the river community. So instead of us telling them how to act, I hope to provide a list of ways that people could connect to community resources. But we do hope that this will continue on beyond our, you know, we're culminating on Earth Day, not to finish the conversation, but to keep it going past that date into the spring. So,
and Board Chair Prince, Board Member Tao, if I could add one addition to that. Russ Stark, in his Chief Resilience Officer capacity, is a member of an Executive Steering Committee for Read Brave this year, which is me and Beth Burns from the Friends, Russ, and then our partners at the Science Museum. And the reason Russ is so engaged is because he saw right away how Read Brave can kind of be a public launching pad to the city's climate action plan and the climate action work, which includes a number of very direct and specific ways St. Paulites can get engaged. And so that plan and all the work that's been done to shape it thus far and that will continue to be done will really be a great resource that we can direct people to when they get to that question, now I've learned a lot, now I'm really committed, what can I do? We can point right to that resource. And Russ has been such a great partner, even to the extent that we submitted a funding request to the McKnight Foundation as a joint request, saying Read Brave is sort of a phase one, and then the climate action planning work is a phase two, but that the two are really linked to try to bring our community together around awareness and engagement in action.
Thank you. That sounds really exciting. I look forward to seeing that in the community. Thank you.
Ms. Joelle Nelson.
Thank you. Thanks. And I know the library to be very, very thoughtful about these things, and I appreciate the points that Councilmember Tao is bringing up. I got to be at a breakfast with Fresh Energy this morning, which brought together climate champions across the Twin Cities, and the theme over and over again was, here's how people experience climate. It's not actually a big technical conversation about science. It's how you experience weather, how it economically impacts you, and then your health, the health impacts of what is happening. And to connect to what Councilmember Tao was saying, I think we can historically see how communities of color and working families are more likely to be connected to climate crisis issues, but it doesn't look and feel that way. It's more like the world that we've constructed around communities that we've disinvested in, more likely to live by freeways built through their neighborhoods, air pollution, air quality, plants and industrial things next to their neighborhoods. And so I think there's a lot of expertise in our community from environmental justice organizers of color who have tried to make these linkages over time in the Twin Cities. And if there's a way to connect program facilitators to the existing folks who've been able to make like a culturally competent curriculum around this, I think that's a huge opportunity, and have some ideas on that. So I very much trust in the work happening. I just want to appreciate the point made and talk about what it makes me think about, because it's a huge chance to bring issues together in a way that sometimes don't always happen, but are very important. So thanks.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Board Chair Prince, Board Member Nelson, we very much welcome any specific suggestions. We have a general sense of the lay of the land. We have some ideas about possible programming direction, but in general as the library, we're really trying to move in this direction of community-informed programming where we have a platform, essentially, but we don't need to own the ideas. We want to invite in others to tell the stories they're telling, and so we will follow up with you about that and really, truly welcome and invite any suggestions you have for people who should be part of Rebrave.
And having started the Marrow Thieves ahead of time, I really appreciate the way in which this will make such a strong connection to our Indigenous communities, because, as you mentioned, on the east side, we're going through a process at the Indian Mounds Park and in the Vento Nature Center where Wakan Tipi is, for our Indigenous Dakota community to reclaim their native sites. And when we think about the 400 years or so that we've been using this land, we have a lot to learn from the indigenous people about how to take care of it better. So, in any event, any further questions, discussion? Thank you so much, Ms. Stalock. It's very exciting.
Thank you for having me.
Item number 3, staff report 19-110, Opus and Olives.
And now we have a word from Beth Burns, who is the executive director of the Friends of the St. Paul Public Library. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much for having me, Board Chair Prince, members of the council. If I might take a moment to just add an endorsement for Read Brave before I give you the Opus and Olives pitch, may I do so?
Yes.
I think one of the things I'm very appreciative about with this program and why the Friends is so excited to support Read Brave, but particularly a Read Brave focused on our climate crisis, is exactly what Ms. Pinkert referred to, this idea of community-informed programming. And I can personally speak to a nonprofit organization with which I am affiliated that is a music organization. It's an artist service organization entitled the Minnesota Music Coalition. And because of the work of the library and because of the leveraging of resources and creating this community-wide conversation, our entire organization is pivoting its major program in 2020 to our climate crisis and creating an entire three-day festival centered around Earth Day that is called Music as a Voice for the Planet. And wow. So we will have 800 people coming into St. Paul for that program directly because of the work of the library. And it's really exciting to see how these things do layer on each other. And I appreciated Councilmember Mitra Jalali Nelson's invitation to really think about how do we intersect with different communities, and if there's a way that the Friends can also lean into your suggestion, we would welcome the opportunity to do so. But we see a lot of organizations kind of coming to the table given the library's leadership in this area, so mm-hmm. grateful for that.
Thank you.
That's why it's fun to raise money for the St. Paul Public Library, and why we are very excited about our largest event, a single day of fundraising for the Friends and for the library, which is coming up a week from Sunday, October 13th. This will be the 16th annual Opus and Olives, and we have 5 authors who we bring in nationally to speak about their work in an environment at the River Center, which will host, we're at 905 guests right now.
Wow.
We still have $6,580 worth of tickets to sell to make a very, very assertive single ticket goal. This is an event that will net more than $200,000 in one evening to benefit the Friends and to benefit the library. This is part of the nearly $1 million that gets transferred this year to the work of the library from the Friends. And it also supports the work of the Friends that we do on our side of the partnership as well. We are really pleased to have so many corporate sponsors that step up to support this event. We know that we are again in direct calendar conflict with the Chamber's Intercity Exchange Program. We are hoping to move away from that in the next couple of years, but it seems not to be having too significant an impact on attendance. I'm grateful for those of you, and there are many of you, who are already supporting this event through your attendance, or your LAs are attending. I certainly want to make sure you understand you can still purchase a ticket, still join us for this really exciting, very, very St. Paul event. I think one of the things I'm excited about is that our work with these publishers has really elevated our ability to leverage the relationship with these publishers who are publishing the books that are Read Brave, that are showing up in the Read Brave portfolio, or showing up with authors that we want to bring into the community for other purposes. We will sell more than $30,000 worth of books in one night at Read Brave as part of that event. That means that when we reach out to publishers and look for deeply, deeply discounted copies of books for programs like Read Brave, they take our call. We have a custom edition, again, coming of Cherie Demeline's book, so that Marrow Thieves will be our edition. It says Read Brave printed on the cover. This is something they do because they know that St. Paul is a literate city. They're excited to invest. And so these partnerships continue to just layer and leverage one on each other. And that includes the work of the City Council functioning as the library board, that you are part of that partnership too, and that the health of our library is really about events like this, programs like Read Brave, the covenant that we have between the private sector fundraising that happens through the Friends and the investment that is made by this City Council and the mayor's office in the budget of the library, and all of those things piece together to create what our community deserves in terms of a healthy, functioning library system.
Thank you, Ms. Burns. Can you tell us all how to access tickets?
I certainly can. For those in the room today, I can hand you an invitation. The Friends website is very, very easy. It's www.thefriends.org. And tickets are, they better be on sale right on the front page of the event. But online ticket sales really are the best way to go. And tickets are $150 per person, $1,500 for a table of 10. And if a corporation wanted to step in at the last minute with a $3,000 sponsorship, we would be delighted to still receive that call, of course.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you for asking.
Thanks to the Friends for their support of our public libraries of nearly $1 million a year and holding us to the highest standards so that the St. Paul Public Library continues to be a national leader. So thank you.
Thank you.
Do we have any other business? Hearing none, Mr. Busori moves to adjourn. How do I mess this up? Mr. Busori moves to adjourn. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes.